With deep learning denoisers, we can start with extremely noisy images and turn them back into something meaningful. But these denoisers don't just learn to recover clean images, they also learn something deeper, the structure of the underlying data distribution. And this connection even becomes explicit thanks to Tweedie's formula. But why is this structure so important? What can we do with it? Let's find out. This video is going to dive deep into some pretty heavy math concepts. So if you're feeling a little rusty or just want to brush up on the fundamentals, don't worry, I've got you covered. Let me introduce you to Brilliant, an incredible platform for learning math, science, and computer science in the most interactive way possible. With thousands of hands-on lessons, it's the perfect companion for anyone looking to level up their understanding. Their bite-sized lessons are designed to make complex topics click. Whether you're tackling derivatives for the first time or building intuition for advanced machine learning algorithms. If my videos ever leave you curious but a bit lost in the math, Brilliant is the perfect way to fill those gaps. So why not give it a shot? You can try Brilliant for free for 30 days by heading to brilliant.org/deepia, scanning the QR code or clicking the link in the description. And as a bonus, you'll also get 20% off an annual premium subscription if you decide you want to continue learning. Let's take a moment to revisit the key elements we're working with. We start with a noisy image, which we'll refer to as Y. Our goal is to denoise this image, and to do that, we pass it through an autoencoder. The autoencoder then outputs a denoised version, which we'll call X hat. However, the denoiser isn't perfect, so X hat still contains some residual noise. So to evaluate its performance, we compare this output, X hat, to the original image, X. This original image is often referred to as the reference, label, or ground truth. If these concepts are not familiar, I think you should check the last video on denoising autoencoders. Now, to train the autoencoder, our objective is to minimize the difference between the denoised estimate X hat and the ground truth X. We repeat this process across all the images in our dataset. So if we have n images, the total loss function is the sum of all the differences between the estimates and the labels. When working with large data sets, which is typically the case, this loss function converges toward the expectation of the difference between the denoised estimates and the ground truths. This expectation is conditional since we have access to the noisy image Y, which we use as input to the denoiser. When we think about minimizing the difference between X hat and X, it's natural to wonder what the denoiser is actually learning. And this brings us to a key result. A trained denoiser approximates the mean of the posterior distribution of X given the noisy input Y. Let's revisit the derivation to make this concept clearer. We start by expressing the L2 norm and the expectation as a dot product. When we expand and distribute the terms, the expectation for the loss function takes this form. Since our trained denoiser minimizes this loss, its derivative with respect to X hat should be zero. When we compute the derivative, we can eliminate any term that doesn't depend on X hat, as its derivative will be zero. Next, we compute the derivative of the remaining terms, which simplifies to this expression. Finally, dividing through by 2 gives us the equality we were looking for. And this is how we show that the denoiser outputs estimates X hat that approximate the posterior mean for each noisy input, Y. Now let's build some intuition with a simple 1D example. Let's say this is the density of the data distribution the denoiser was trained on. For simplicity, we take a Gaussian, but in reality, this distribution is likely far more complex. Now here is our noisy observation, Y, along with the Gaussian likelihood associated with Gaussian noise. Using these two densities, we can plot the posterior distribution, which represents how likely a reconstruction X hat is given the noisy observation Y. This posterior takes into account both the prior, representing the underlying data distribution, and the likelihood, describing how the noise affects the observation. As you can see, the most probable reconstruction lies in the middle of these two factors. This point where the posterior is maximized is called the maximum a posteriori estimate, or MAP. But where is the posterior mean? Well, in this simple Gaussian example, the posterior mean happens to coincide with the map. Now let's consider a more complex prior distribution, for instance, a mixture of Gaussians. With this change, the posterior density also becomes more complex. As you can see, there are now multiple local maxima in the posterior. And if we plot the posterior mean, we see that it no longer aligns with any of these maxima. So what does this mean for our neural network? It means the model outputs reconstructions that are good on average, but these reconstructions may not always be the best possible outcomes for individual observations. Now let's explore how the posterior mean connects to the score of the data distribution through Tweedie's formula. This is the well-known Tweedie formula, which comes up a lot in diffusion models literature. As you can see, it connects the posterior mean to the score of the noisy data distribution. And we know that the posterior mean is basically what we aim to approximate when we train our denoiser. Now the score is just the gradient of the log probability of the noisy data. If this sounds new to you, check out the previous video on denoising autoencoders for a quick intro. The steps to derive Tweedie's formula are pretty simple, so let's go through them together. First, we will expand the expression of the score of the noisy distribution. The gradient of the log of a function is the ratio between the gradient of that function and the function itself. Next, we marginalize the noisy distribution P of y by expressing it in terms of the likelihood P of I given x. If you don't recall why we can do that, let's just say it's like expressing P of y as the sum of all its slices. Then we take the gradient with respect to y on both sides. With some assumptions on the regularity of the distributions, we are allowed to move the gradient operator inside the integral. So this shows that the gradient of P of y directly depends on the gradient of the likelihood. That concludes the first step of the derivations, which were basically just marginalizing the density. Now let's recall the expression of the likelihood in the case of Gaussian noise, just in case you don't remember it. Since the likelihood is proportional to an exponential function, differentiating it shouldn't be too difficult. We simply differentiate the expression inside the parentheses, which is just a Euclidean distance, and place it in front of the exponential. Substituting this into our earlier expression for the gradient of P of y gives us this pretty scary integral. That wraps up the second step, that involved replacing the likelihood with its explicit form. Next, since the integral is linear, we can actually split the previous expression into two separate terms. On the left-hand side, we notice this is just the marginalization of P of y, so this whole integral is just the noisy input y times P of y. On the right-hand side, we recognize an expectation due to the x appearing as a factor. We don't show the calculations here, but trust me that using Bayes' formula here shows that this is the posterior mean multiplied by P of y. From this point, we simply divide everything by P of y to arrive at Tweedie's formula. All right, you can sit back and catch your breath now, because we're about to dive into some fun animations to make all of this much clearer. As usual, let's think of the image space as a simple two-dimensional plane with points representing images. For instance, we can imagine that we work with natural images like handwritten digits. And these images probably lie on some complex underlying structure in the image space. Now, what happens if we add a bit of Gaussian noise to these images? Well, we will create images that are relatively close to the originals in the image space. The noisy images sort of spread out around the clean ones, following the shape of a Gaussian. As you can see, each of these noisy points, y, is a slightly corrupted version of the original image. And of course, all these noisy points also follow an underlying density, which depends on the original distribution of images and the noise level we applied. Here you can see this density that we note as P of y, with local maximums located where the clean data was. If you remember the previous part of the video, you know that this distribution is the one we're working with when we use our trained neural network. Or rather, the denoiser approximates the score of this noisy data distribution. The score is basically a vector field that shows the direction where the probability is highest at any point in the image space. You can think of it as a sort of equivalent of the derivative, but for probability distributions. It will be very large when we are away from the original distribution and very small when we're near. When we apply the denoiser to an image, Tweedie's formula tells us that this is like taking a small step toward the high density regions of the noisy data distribution, P of y. So we can think of the network as a sort of compass that gives us an idea of where the original data is most likely to be and displaces the input towards this direction. No matter what image you feed into the network, it will point roughly toward the closest area where the original data density was high. We'll now take a quick tangent to talk about other means of obtaining this compass that we'll later use to generate brand new data. Until recently, approximating the score of an unknown data distribution P of X was actually a challenging problem. Today, we use neural networks that are trained to denoise images, but this approach wasn't always the norm. In fact, what we now call denoising score matching was only formally introduced in 2010 by Pascal Vincent in his paper titled "A Connection Between Score Matching and Denoising Autoencoders." At the time, this idea didn't gain the attention it deserved. It was only in the 2020s when Yang Song began publishing his work on score-based generative models that denoising score matching really became popular. This is because denoising is also the training objective of diffusion models, which are still the state of the art in image generation as of 2024. Now let's see why score matching was a hard problem to solve for such a long time. One naive approach is to directly optimize for the score function of the data distribution. But here's the problem. In most real-world scenarios, we don't actually know the true density function of our data. So what can we do? Well, in 2005, Apo Haverinen proposed a method that reformulated the problem into a minimization objective that doesn't rely on the ground truth score anymore. Instead, this new formulation works with the trace of the Jacobian of the score function and the norm of the score itself. At the time, this was a major step forward because it provided a theoretical way to approximate any distribution as long as we could sample from it. However, this method came with its own challenges. The computation of the Jacobian and its trace scales poorly with the dimensionality of the data. For high-dimensional data, such as images, this approach quickly becomes infeasible. On the other hand, denoising score matching completely avoids these issues. It just relies on adding Gaussian noise to images and computing a lot of L2 distances. Today, denoising score matching is the most widely used approach, not just because it works well, but also because it's theoretically grounded and simple to implement. With this tool in hand, we can now focus on how to use the estimated score to generate new images. Let's revisit our previous example involving a mixture of two Gaussian distributions. We have some data samples and we know the underlying probability distribution is a mixture of Gaussians. We've also trained a neural network to approximate the score function of this distribution. As we've seen, the score function gives us the direction of maximum probability at any point in space. It acts as a sort of compass that always points toward the nearest region of high probability. But what happens if, instead of just observing this compass, we actually follow it? If we do, we'll move directly toward a high probability region, making our samples increasingly likely with respect to the underlying distribution. Mathematically, this process can be written as a gradient ascent on the score of the distribution. Well, except that instead of using the real score, we use the approximation provided by our neural network. But here's the catch. If we only perform regular gradient ascent, we won't generate diverse samples from the distribution. Instead, if we let the algorithm run for a lot of iterations, we'll simply end up at the local maxima, and we will always end up with the same points, no matter where we start. To solve this, we introduce a small random perturbation into each update. This small perturbation is basically some Gaussian noise scaled by the gradient step size. This tiny dose of stochasticity ensures that our trajectory remains random enough to avoid converging to a single point, even after many iterations. And now if we apply this modified algorithm, called the Langevin algorithm, to a large set of initial points, something interesting happens. The points naturally accumulate around the two Gaussian clusters without collapsing to a single point, and we end up with a distribution of samples that is very close to the original one. If we compare our simulated samples to the real ones, they're indeed pretty similar. Now let's see how we can implement the Langevin algorithm to generate new images. We will now implement everything that we've seen so far using Python. We'll start by training the neural network. we will use two Python libraries, PyTorch and another library called DeepInverse that provides pre-implemented denoising models. First, we define the usual training parameters, such as the number of epochs and the batch size. Then we load the MNIST dataset using Torch Vision. The next step is to set up the noising operation. With DeepInverse, this is straightforward since it only requires specifying the noise level sigma. Once the noise is configured, we choose a state-of-the-art architecture like Drunet, along with the MSE loss. Now we can write the standard PyTorch training loop. For each epoch, we iterate over batches of data, apply noise to each batch, and feed it into the denoising network. The network predicts a denoised output, and we compute the mean squared error between this output and the original clean data. We then backpropagate the error through the network to update its parameters. Over time, as we process more batches, the loss should decrease, eventually approaching zero after a few epochs. Once training is complete, we can test the model to ensure it works as expected. For instance, we can feed it noisy inputs and verify that the network outputs clean images. Here you can see that the model does a great work at removing the noise, so we can now integrate it into the Langevin algorithm. Let's implement it step by step, just like we did for the training. First, we need to define the two main parameters, the number of iterations and the gradient step size. We usually choose a small gradient step size and a large number of iterations. Then we load a sample and we add noise to it. After that, we move on to the Langevin algorithm itself, which is essentially a for loop. At each step, we compute the approximate score using our Denoiser and Tweedie's formula. We then plug this score into the Langevin update, which combines the previous iteration with the score and some additional noise. If we use this image of a 5 as input, the bottom of your screen shows 8 different starting points for the Langevin algorithm, and we run the sampling process on each of them. As the iterations progress, the Gaussian noise is gradually removed, and we can see new details emerge on all the samples. The final samples differ only slightly from one another and remain too close to the original image. Maybe we could try to start from pure noise instead. Surely the end images won't look similar, right? Now we take 16 samples, all starting from pure noise. Well, as you can see, if we start from pure Gaussian noise, the algorithm is struggling to converge to meaningful solutions, and we end up with a soup of black and white pixels instead of the handwritten digits we were expecting. So why does this happen in practice when the theory suggests it should work perfectly? In fact, there's a subtle detail we overlooked and it causes everything to break. The issue is in fact pretty simple. When we estimate the score of the data distribution using denoising score matching, we estimate the score using noisy samples. Unfortunately, this means that in regions with no samples, we don't have a reliable estimation of the score. So let's say that this mixture of Gaussians is again our noisy data distribution. There are two regions of the image space where we have no samples at all, so in these regions, our score estimate will be really bad. When we start the Langevin algorithm with pure Gaussian noise, we're essentially in these regions of our noisy distribution. So what happens is that our score is so inaccurate that the Langevin algorithm just wanders aimlessly, and we stay in these low probability regions without ever reaching the high probability ones. One possible workaround would be to smooth the score by adding even more noise to the data during the training. Indeed, by increasing the noise level, we can fill in the gaps in low density regions, making the score more consistent across the entire space. However, this solution comes at a cost. Adding more noise makes the score less precise everywhere, not just in the low-density regions. This creates a trade-off. We want to fill in the low-density regions while still preserving a sharp and accurate score estimate in high-density areas. And the solution to this trade-off is actually the topic of the next video, diffusion models. Thank you so much for watching this video. Remember to like and subscribe to support the channel. I'll take some time off before the next video, so see you next time and Happy New Year!